Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Book of Hedge Druidry, A Complete Guide for the Solitary Seeker, by Joanna Vanderhoeven, narrated by Coleen Marlo. Publisher's note: this audiobook includes bonus material. Please visit tantor.com and type Book of Hedge Druidry into the search box. Follow the link to the book's page. Then, under the supplemental content section, please enter the access code PATH and then click the unlock button to access the bonus material. The code should be entered in all lowercase letters. All figures and tables referenced in this audiobook can be found in the bonus material. Disclaimer: the publisher and the author assume no liability for any injuries caused to the reader that may result from the reader's use of content contained in this publication, and recommend common sense when contemplating the practices described in the work. Please consult a standard reference source or an expert herbalist to learn more about the possible effects of certain herbs. Introduction. She walks toward the hedge, the boundary that separates the farmer's field from the village, a line that runs down to a wooded area and the heathland beyond. When she reaches the hedge of hawthorn, blackthorn, and dogrose, a triad of wild and native plants that hold ancient and special meaning, she smiles and reaches out to stroke a rosehip. The cool autumn breeze plays in her hair, whipping it around her face as the sun spills its light in waves across the landscape, the sky dotted with huge puffy clouds. It is harvest time, when nature's abundance is at its peak. She feels the strength of the ancestors flowing through her blood and bones and hears their song in the wind. She says a quick prayer to the ancestors and blesses the land and the ongoing harvest, even as the sound of heavy farm machinery floats upon the breeze. She turns and follows the hedgerow down to the little woodland, a special place that bursts with bluebells in the spring. In this place, she stands for a moment, utterly still, listening to the sounds of the spirits of place, the robins and blackbirds, a pheasant squawking, a hawk crying high overhead, riding the thermals. This is the edge, where the hedge meets the wild, where the known meets the unknown. The civilized comes up against the wild. Here, at the edge, is the special place, the in-between place. This is where she belongs. Inviting the power of the ancestors to flow through her, inviting the gods and goddesses that she loves, inviting the spirits of place to join with her intention, she turns three times anti-clockwise and sings. Once she has stopped, she knows that she walks between the worlds, that the other world is all around her and she can seek its wisdom and guidance while testing her courage and her wits. Here she will find the answer to help her in her quest. Here she will find the inspiration, known to the druids as Awen. Here is where the magic happens. Here she walks as a hedge druid. Druidry is a deeply fulfilling earth-based spirituality. Western spiritual traditions often differ from, say, Eastern traditions, in that they can be a more solo affair. Our mythology is filled with tales of a hero or heroine on a quest, and it is that quest which seems to be a recurring theme. There are challenges and people to help along the way. But on the whole, the quest must be fulfilled by the seeker and the seeker alone. With Buddhism, one often has a community, a sangha, a teacher to go to, monasteries and abbeys, and more. Western paganism is a bit different, but fast-growing with events, organizations, festivals, schools, colleges, and more. Perhaps in our lifetime we will see the equivalent of pagan monasteries and abbeys, where the priesthood or those wishing to live a life entirely dedicated to their pagan religion is sanctioned, widely accepted, and has community financial support. However, the point remains that the solo quest has been and most likely will always be central to Western paganism. This quest can be seen in many different ways. It could be a quest to find the true nature of the self. It could be a quest on behalf of another person, or a spiritual quest to find communion and integrate with the gods, a form of mysticism, if you will. Often we are seeking to bring disparate parts of our own soul back together, to find the whole once again, to bring a holistic view into our ever-increasing disparate and isolationist society. When we find the whole within our own self, we find the whole within the community and the world. Druidry is no exception. Druidry is the quest to find our place in the world and to work in the world in balance and harmony. It is being a part of a functioning ecosystem, to learn its ways and find how we too can be a contributing member. We might be seeking the divine in order to build that bridge that allows us to understand how to find our place in the world. Or we might be trying to connect with our ancestors and their knowledge of the world. We might look to the spirits of place or to the fair folk for guidance and inspiration on how we walk in this world and the other world, in balance and for the benefit of all. For the other world is also a part of this world, overlaying it and offering a different perspective on the nature of things. We need this different perspective in order to step outside of our narrow, human-centric perspective, to enable us to see the bigger picture. And so we might quest to the other world as well, to gain this broader viewpoint, finding guides and companions that can provide knowledge and insight for us to take back into this world. What is most important is that one actually begins the quest. So often we can just think about it, contemplate it, talk about it, but not actually do anything about it. We must be bold and take those first steps and then have the fortitude to see it through. Should our paths turn away from our original goal, then we must pursue those if we feel that is the right thing to do. But as long as we are walking on the path, as long as we are actually doing the work and not just thinking about it, then we are on the mythic quest that is so much a part of our Western heritage. Along the way, we will find great joy and sadness, great courage and great fear. We will face those parts of ourselves that we would rather hide away. We will also acknowledge our gifts, talents, and abilities to be able to use them to their best advantage. But we cannot do it if we are not actively engaged on the quest. So be bold, take those first steps and see where they may lead, for no one else can walk the path for you. Great adventure awaits. I hope to share with you in this work the inspiration and knowledge that I have received over the years. May you find the path rise to meet your feet. May you walk it with integrity and honor.
Anachvo dukri isana, haurfos do kosihu.
Your feet will bring you to where your heart is. Part 1. Theory. Here is where we explore the theory behind Druidry. We will look at who the Druids were and who they are today. We will look at different concepts and cosmology in the Druid tradition, such as the Awen, the gods, the ancestors, the other world, and more. We look more closely at what it means to be a hedge druid and the importance of the hedge in the tradition. We also look at the festivals celebrated in Druidry, following the wheel of the year as well as the cycle of the moon. We will also look at meditation, prayer, magic, and animism within the Druid tradition. These concepts form the basic grounding of the Druid tradition, the theory behind the practice. Chapter 1. The Druids. There weren't always Druids in the world. The Druids have had their name from the Iron Age onward. What they were called before then, we simply do not know. What we do know is that they held a high status in the community, advising kings, divining auguries, healing the sick, and more. The accounts that we have are still rather scarce, however. The Druids followed an oral tradition, believing strongly in the power of memory and recall in order to follow their path. What was written down was done so by often opposing forces, such as the Romans, and therefore we have to take what was said about the Druids with a pinch of salt. I think that it is fairly safe to assume that before Druidry, there was a shamanistic, animistic religion or spirituality practiced here in the British Isles, and even before they became an island nation. From the retreat of the last ice age, when the land known as Doggerland, that connected Great Britain to the continent, became flooded beneath the North Sea on the east coast of England, there has evolved a different people, a different way of life. The people that lived in the British Isles became changed from those on the continent, though they still held very similar beliefs. sharing an ancient, prehistoric ancestral root, they still continued to evolve and adapt to their surroundings, and so the religion was shaped by the new islands upon which they lived, as all religions are shaped by their environment. One theory is the Druidry, evolved from the indigenous spirituality of the British Isles and was influenced by the Celts. There is another theory that the Celts brought Druidry with them as they traversed westward across Europe. With this theory, Druidry did not originate in Britain. There are a couple of schools of thought on that matter. One point of view that meets halfway is that there still continued to be religious practice on the British Isles since the Stone Age and beyond, which then evolved much later into Druidry, with the influence of the migrating Iron Age Celts, an amalgam that eventually evolved to what we have today. In this theory, there is no unbroken lineage of Druidry per se, but an evolution of religious practice much like everywhere else in the world. The Celts may have brought ideas with them that shaped the Druidry of the Iron Age, as other religions today influence modern Druidry, such as concepts from Native American animistic traditions, or even exploring the Indo-European shared roots through the Vedic traditions of the East. Others might say that the Celts came to these islands and brought their fully-fledged Druid traditions with them. Neither theory has been proven or unproven, though the former feels more correct to me. The megalithic stone temples and prehistoric monuments were built right up until around 1400 BCE, before the Celts arrived in Britain. It is still debated whether the proto-Celts, who may have arrived around 2000 BCE, were associated with these temples or not. But if so, then it is possible that a form of Druidry associated with them has existed since before recorded history began. However, opinion is still divided, and many scholars seem to hold that the Celts came to these isles in waves of invasions, who had no recent link to the Stone Age or Bronze Age Britons of the time or to their religious traditions. We have no definitive answers and can only go by our instinct based upon the evidence we have. Druidry historically can be found throughout the British Isles, as well as in other places throughout Europe, such as ancient Gaul, an area that covered a large region of Western Europe during the Iron Age period. It was inhabited by Celtic tribes and encompassed present-day France, Luxembourg, most of Switzerland, Belgium, and northern Italy. It also contained parts of the Netherlands and Germany on the west bank of the Rhine. Julius Caesar and Diodorus Siculus recorded their perceptions of the Druids in the 1st century BCE. From these classical sources, much of modern Druidry draws its knowledge. The Druids were the priest caste of Celtic society, exempt from service in war, among other privileges. Indeed, the image of the wise Druid worshipping in a grove in a forest comes from these classical sources. So too, of course, does images of burning people alive in wicker constructs and horrible other means of sacrifice. We just don't know what is truth and what is fiction, what is fact, and what is Roman propaganda. Christianity came to these shores in the 5th century, and another layer of gloss was added to the story of the Druids. Many earthly energies and powers of nature became canonized as saints, such as the goddess Brigid becoming Saint Bridget. Churches were built upon ancient pagan sites of worship. Some claim that a form of Druidry merged with Christianity, forming a Christic path known as Culdi. In Ireland at this time, Christian monks began recording the ancient laws, for which we are very grateful. But again, we have to accept that it is a form of differing perspective and religious tradition that they are derived, with its own biases and prejudices. We also have to recognize what they don't say, what they haven't recorded. Much of the Welsh mythology was recorded and written down at this time, and we have to differentiate the older teachings and nature-based ways of being from these Christianized accounts. The 17th and 18th centuries saw the Druid revival, stemming from a romantic notion of Druidry in an era when industrialization of the country was becoming rampant. It was a reaction to the factories as much as a longing to return to the ancient traditions of these isles. Colored by pastoral poetry and art, and led by early proto-archaeologists such as William Stukeley, they jumped to many conclusions while creating a very structured nature-based religion. However, the gods of nature and nature itself are never as ordered as we would like to have them. In more recent history, the 1940s and 1950s, two men, Gerald Gardner and Ross Nichols joined the ancient Druid order, which began in the early 20th century. Between them, they came up with the 8 festivals that are now celebrated in modern Western paganism, largely in the traditions of Druidry and Wicca, based upon their knowledge and research of older pre-Christian traditions, mainly from a Celtic source. Gerald Gardner became the father of modern Wicca, and Ross Nichols became the figurehead of modern Druidry, and chief of the Order of Bards, Ovates, and Druids, OBOD. Gardner and Nichols were good friends and shared many thoughts and beliefs. Hence, you will see many similarities today between modern Druidry and Wicca. An example of this is in the 3 strands of Druidry, Bards, Ovates, and Druids, found in OBOD and other Druid systems, and the 3 levels of initiation found in modern Wicca, 1st, 2nd, and 3rd degree witches. The 8 holy days are shared, 4 of which are ancient Celtic festivals, as well as the honoring of the phases of the moon in most traditions. Much of the mythology stems from British Celtic sources and concepts. There is a similar belief in reincarnation and the afterlife, which is also apparent in both traditions. The list goes on. So how old is Druidry then? Modern Druidry dates back to Ross Nichols in the middle of last century. How long does the spirit of Druidry go back in time? Who knows? A religion is always evolving, adapting, and changing, especially a religion of nature. Nature changes with the seasons, times of light and darkness, and the ebb and flow of the tide. We could follow some of those threads all the way back to the Stone Age and beyond if we wished, but they are only threads and not the whole tapestry. There was a school of thought, which is now changing, that antiquity equated to validity. Yet just because something is old doesn't mean it's right or relevant. The threads of Druidry could be very ancient indeed, as ancient as the first time humans walked upon these lands or older, because the powers of nature are as old as nature itself, regardless of whether humans have worshipped it or not. We must learn all that we can from history, even when it is ever-changing with new light and facts coming to the fore. But we should not confuse antiquity and validity on a spiritual path. Things evolve all the time. Things become outdated, irrelevant, and sometimes even illegal. Modern Druidry is seeing a large increase in numbers, especially since the 1990s and the coming of the new millennium. There are many more writers on the subject being published and many more different voices being heard. From the late 90s onward, women's voices began to be heard again in the community, for there were always female Druids in ancient times, though during the Victorian era and to the latter half of the 20th century era, men dominated, offering their perspective, their experience, and their knowledge, both academic and experiential. Today we very much have a balanced form of Druidry, where men and women are equally represented, but that hasn't always been the case. Starting with the coming of the Romans and then Christians, women in religion, politics, and many other places have taken a back seat, not holding any authority or power. But today we are seeing the balance being redressed in modern paganism and in Druidry, despite women's power still being under the secular threat from governments even such as our own today. The world stands at a precipice, where the urge to hold on to power without service provides one with the empty comfort of rewarding the ego. Those rewards are sugary little sweets that have no substance, no meaning. They are empty, devoid of nourishment. Only when we take responsibility for all the damage that we have done and seek to redress the balance will we ever survive. Even though we claim assurances from modern science, still we are very afraid of everything. We think we are not afraid of nature, that we have controlled it, but anyone witnessing a tsunami or earthquake knows otherwise. We are still monkeys running around scared for the most part, reacting to our world instead of acting with intention. We react to protect our egos, our sense of self, but only when we realize that there is no separate self, that we are all related, will that fear leave us. That is the essence of Druidry. It is connection, being part of an ecosystem, weaving the threads of inspiration, and finding our place in the world, in the here and now, in harmony and with respect. The Hedge Druid. The Hedge Druid is a more recent term that applies to someone who walks the Druid path for the most part alone, using their wit and intelligence. The wisdom gained from long hours of research and practical experience in order to create their own tradition that is right for them and their environment. The term hedge, when applied to druidry, stems from the 19th century term hedge priest, which denoted a priest of the Christian faith who did not follow a particular or established tradition, had no church per se, and who preached from the hedgerow. The term was first applied to witchcraft in modern paganism and popularized by the author Ray Beth. The term then spread to druidry and became synonymous with solitary practitioners, who were not part of any order, grove, group, or other established sect. Not all solitary practitioners of druidry would call themselves hedge druids. However, it is a term that is growing in popularity. In this work, I shall show how hedge druidry goes beyond the notion of a solitary practitioner into something that is deeper and more connected to the natural world. The hedge druid is also one who rides the hedge, who travels between the worlds, who works with boundaries and the liminal places where the edges blend and meet. The term hedge riding is a practice found in the pagan community, mostly in witchcraft traditions. It stems from the German word Hagazisa, which means hedge sitter. The Saxon term is Hagtessa, and both are where we get our word hag. Someone who rides the hedge can straddle the worlds, this world and the other world, to bring back wisdom and information to use in our world, the middle world. We will learn more about the importance of the hedge and also hedge riding in later chapters. Suffice it to say that the work of the boundaries of the civilized world, as well as that which lies beyond the hedgerow, is the world of the hedge druid, connecting and weaving together those threads to shape the world and find balance and harmony with the whole. It is the known world and the wilderness beyond that shapes and informs our earth-based tradition. For me, druidry is mostly a solitary path, though I do belong to some druid orders and to networks and celebrate the seasons with a few friends. But the everyday druidry, the currents of intention that flow through me, my home and the landscape where I live, is my main focus. It is a mostly solitary pursuit. Like learning, I always preferred to do it on my own rather than working with a group, for I found that my concentration was higher and I could have a deeper level of experience than I could with the influence of others upon my work. The day-to-day living of my druid path is what is most important, punctuated by the celebration of the seasons and festivals with others. Of course, we are never truly solitary creatures, but in this sense, I am using the word solitary with regards to other humans. I am never truly solitary, for I am always surrounded by nature and all its creatures every single second of my life. I am always part of an interconnected web of existence. Living this connection, weaving the threads of my life to that of my environment and all that exists within it, means that there is no separation, no isolation. Yet when asked to describe my path, I use the term solitary or hedge druid in the sense that I prefer to find such connection on my own, without other humans around. Why this should be so is perhaps due to my nature, naturally shy and sensitive to noise, light, barometric pressure, and other phenomena. It is just easier to be alone most of the time. It is similar to the path of the mystic or a monastic. The path of the mystic is much the same, a solitary path where personal connection to the divine is the central focus. Some would say that the mystic path is the search for the nature of reality. For me, druidry is the search for reality within nature, and so the two can walk hand in hand down this forest path. There are many elements of mysticism in my everyday life, where the songs of the land and the power of the gods flow through me, the knowledge from the ancestors deep within my blood and deep within the land upon which I live, rooted in its soil and sharing its stories on the breeze. To hold that connection, day in and day out, to live life fully within the threads of that tapestry is what I aspire to do, each and every moment. Sometimes a thread is dropped, and it requires a deep mindfulness to restore it. But practice helps when we search for those connecting threads, becoming easier with time and patience both with the world and with your own self. The monastic, however, retreats from the world to connect with the essence of the divine. There is a deliberate intention to be separate from the so-called mundane world or secular culture. However, within Druidry, we realize that there is no such thing as mundane, and the duality between the physical and the spiritual is something that is anathema to the tradition. Learning how to be in the world is of great value, even as great value is found in being alone. For some, I'm sure a monastic druid tradition would be a most agreeable way to live. But for most, they prefer to work in the world rather than separate from it, because they understand that separation is merely an illusion. Most non-gregarious druids would prefer the path of the mystic rather than the monastic for that very reason. The mystic seeks integration, the monastic separation. Yet both have many other similarities. Both seek to release the vice-like grip we have on our sense of self, the ego that we try to protect at all costs. The dissolution of the ego can be seen as at the heart of many Eastern traditions. Druidry teaches this integration, our ego perhaps not dissolving, but blending in with that of our own environment. We don't think less of ourselves, but rather think of ourselves less. The animism that is a large part of Druidry for many helps us to see the sacredness of all existence, and in doing so we are not seeking annihilation, but integration. We can perhaps dissolve the notions and outdated perceptions that we have, both about the world and about ourselves, leaving the self to find its own edges and then blending into the world around us, truly becoming part of an ecosystem where selflessness is not altruistic, but necessary for the survival of the system. The flowing inspiration, otherwise known as the Awen, where soul touches soul and the edges melt away into an integrated way of being, has always been at the heart of Druidry. The three drops of inspiration or wisdom from the goddess Caradwyn's cauldron contain that connection. They contain the Awen that, with enough practice, is accessible to all. We have to spend time brewing our own cauldron of inspiration, filling it with both knowledge and experience, before we can taste the delicious Awen upon our lips. Some prefer to do this with others. Some prefer to do so alone. It is easier to quiet the noise of humanity and of our own minds when we are alone without distraction. Notice I said easier and not easy, because again it takes practice. But time spent alone, daily connecting and reweaving the threads that we have dropped, can help us create a wonderful, rich tapestry that inspires us to continue in our journey through life, whatever may happen along the way. Though the solitary path might not be for everyone, having these moments of solitude can be a great tool for deep learning, working on your own as well as working within a group, grove, or order. Sometimes we need to remove ourselves from the world in order to better understand it, and then come back into the fold with a new awareness and integration filled with Awen. The Hedge Druid is not afraid to be alone, nor with others, but seeks deep and utter integration in the world. Being a hedge druid requires determination in seeking out the ancient and modern lore and finding what aspects resonate within our soul. Not everything ancient is valid today, and not all modern aspects have integrity. We need to take a step back from declaring authenticity when there is doubt and instead search for validity in our spiritual path. The hedge druid learns to walk her path with integrity, with solid research and experiential wisdom. She does the work, in the physical as well as the academic. Our learning is our own personal responsibility, and I hope that this book helps you on your way. Throughout, we will glimpse little snapshots of a hedge druid as she goes about her path honoring the natural world around her, filled with wonder and enchantment. She closes the book, her hand running down the front cover, feeling the energy of the words flowing through her mind. She thinks about the history, what the ancients may have seen, what they may have done. She takes in a deep breath and knows that she will never stop learning, whether from books, friends, strangers, or personal experience. She looks out the window and sees a blackbird, a druid dobe, alight upon the branches of the elder tree. It begins to sing its evening song as the village settles into quiet. She nods to herself and says a prayer of blessing on her work and research before heading into the kitchen to make some tea. Chapter 2. The Awen. The Awen symbol is based on an original design by the 18th to 19th century Druid revivalist,
Iallu Morganuk.
It consists of three lines falling to the right, center, and left. Modern Druidry incorporates the original source point of three dots, which can either be seen as points of light or drops from the cauldron of the goddess Caradwyn. The Awen symbol represents, among other things, the triple nature of the Druid path, incorporating the paths of bard, obeid, and druid.
It is not an ancient symbol, but a modern druid symbol, used widely by druids the world over, regardless of their opinion on Iallu and his work.
The first recorded reference to the Awen occurs in Nennius's Historia Brittonum, a Latin text of circa 796 CE. Talhern Tad Awen won renown in poetry, is where we first see the word, and it tells us that Talhern is the father of Awen in this instance. Sadly, this source tells us nothing more about Talhern as being the father of Awen, but perhaps later research may discover more clues about this reference. A common translation of the Welsh word Awen is flowing inspiration, or flowing poetry, poetic insight. Awakening to our own energy and stretching out toward the energy of nature around us, we begin to see just what is the Awen. It is an opening of oneself, of one's spirit or soul, in order to truly and very deeply see and connect all life around us. When we are open, we can receive that divine gift, the inspiration that flows, whether it is from deity, nature, or whatever it is that you choose to focus on. For Awen to exist, there must be relationship. We cannot be inspired unless we are open, and we cannot be open unless we have established a relationship, whether that is with the thunder, the blackbird, or a god. It is cyclical in nature. We open and give of ourselves, and in doing so, we receive, and vice versa. Letting go, releasing into that flow of Awen, allows it to flow ever more freely, and we find ourselves inspired not only in fits and bursts of enlightenment or inspiration, but all the time, carrying that essence of connection and wonder with us. There is, of course, a line to be drawn, for we can't be off our heads in ecstatic relationship with everything all the time. As with all language, a literal translation can be far too limiting. It's good to have a context and some sort of description to relate the concept. But when confined to literalism, we get stuck and are unable to see the bigger picture. Awen does mean flowing inspiration. But what is inspiration? A really good idea, a bolt from the blue, is one interpretation. However, there are many others. Inspiration is not just something that happens to us. It is something that we can cultivate in true relationship. We are not subject to the whims of inspiration, but rather can access that inspiration on a daily basis through deep relationship. Indeed, Awen is all about relationship, more than it being a really good idea. When we literally translate Awen into inspiration, we can lose that context of relationship. With good relationship, we will have good ideas. When soul touches soul, there is an energy, a source of inspiration. When we are aware of our soul interacting with other souls, we can harness that inspiration and see it in everything that we do. It doesn't just happen every now and then like a bolt out of the blue, but rather is in everything that we do. It requires a willingness for deep relationship and a desire to be mindful of all our relationships. This may sound a lot like Eastern philosophy, being very mindful. Mindfulness is a large part of many Eastern philosophies, but I am sure that it has been around as long as human self-awareness has been around. Indeed, it may have been a large part of ancient Druidry, now lost to the mists of time. Taking inspiration from Eastern traditions with regard to our way of thinking is not much different from reading the works of Nietzsche or Plato. There is no monopoly on wisdom. Mindfulness relates to Awen in that when we are aware of our relationship to the world, when we see how we fit in the world, we can work in harmony with the world. we become an integral and integrated part of an ecosystem, where we know that everything that we do matters to the system in its entirety. The discipline gained from such mindfulness as practiced in the Eastern traditions and philosophies can be a great teacher in expanding our minds and helping us to learn more about ourselves. That also goes for other religions and philosophies as well. I'm sure the ancient Druids, just as much as modern Druids today, loved reading about world religions and discussing philosophy. There is a lot of talk about cultural appropriation in modern paganism, however, and it's something that needs to be carefully considered. We do have to be aware of when we are taking something from another culture without its proper context and permission. Nevertheless, with religions or traditions such as Buddhism, for example, the Buddha said that enlightenment was for anyone to achieve, available to all, regardless of where they came from, whatever their background. It's why we see so many different forms of Buddha being represented in sculpture. We have fat Buddhas from China, great slim standing Buddhas in India, reclining Buddhas in Myanmar, sitting Buddhas carved straight out of the rock temples in Sri Lanka, elegant bronze-plated Buddhas in Japan, and so on. In each country, the Buddha looks different, as Buddha is within each and every person as well as having been a person in his own right. There is even a female Buddha known as Tara in Vajrayana Buddhism. You will find that Druidry has much in common with many other earth-based religions the world over, as well as many philosophies, both ancient and modern. We can be inspired by these and let them help us to change our perception, our way of seeing the world, from a self-centered point of view to a more holistic worldview, from a less human-centered perspective to one that is more integrated. In that, we are living the Awen. Awen is that spark set off by interaction, by integration. We do not exist in a bubble. We are surrounded by the world at all times, by the seen and the unseen. When we live integrated, we see the meaning that each relationship has, and that inspires us to live our lives accordingly. That inspiration is the heart and soul of Druidry. Inspiration, to inspire, from the Latin inspirare, the act of breathing. Indeed, it has many connotations to breathe and breathing. Awen can connect us to the world through the very act of breathing. All living things breathe in some form on this planet. The human species shares this breath, breathing in the oxygen created on this planet and exhaling it into the twilight. The air that we breathe has been recycled by plants and creatures for billions of years. The breath is the gateway to the ancestors and to a deep understanding of the nature of Awen. Awen is also shared inspiration, for we share this planet with everything else on it. Everything that we do has an impact. Every breath we take, every action that we make. Breath links us to everything else. When we remember that deep connection to everything else, we cannot help but be inspired, and we hope to inspire in return, much as our own exhalation is valuable to trees and plants who take in the carbon dioxide, turning it to oxygen for our own breath. Inspiration and expiration, inhalation and exhalation are all words for the act of breathing. Remembering the shared breath of the world, we come home to ourselves and rediscover the wonder and awe of existence. Then we are truly inspired. So where does the flowing inspiration of modern Druidry come from then? And what is the difference between Awen and the energy that is in all life? In Welsh, we can trace it back to the 19th century, where aw means flowing or fluidity, and wen is spirit or a being. We can more easily trace the concept and word back to medieval texts, retelling the tale of Ceridwen and Taliesin. The goddess Ceridwen was brewing a special potion for her son, a Fajju, tended by Gwion Bach. Some of the brew bubbled over, and three drops scalded Gwion as he stirred the pot, so he put his thumb into his mouth to ease the soreness, taking in the magic of the brew meant for a Fajju. Ceridwen was enraged and chased him, eventually eating him and then giving birth to him again. After she gives birth to him, she sets him on a boat, and he was discovered alive and well later, and renamed Taliesin for his radiant brow. He becomes the most famous bard of Britain. The Awen can be seen as being achieved through a deep connection to every aspect of the land, in whatever shape or form. The Awen can be seen as being achieved through a deep connection to every aspect of the land, in whatever shape or form. We can undergo a kind of initiation into the Awen, much as Gwion Bach did, through the goddess Caradwyn and her special brew. We can drink from the cauldron of inspiration. But with that come great trials and tribulations that go hand in hand with awareness and enlightenment. The Awen is also related to water and rivers, and not just the liquid brewed in Caradwyn's cauldron. In the medieval poem, The Hostile Confederacy, from the Book of Taliesin, it states, "The Awen I sing, from the deep I bring it. A river while it flows, I know its extent. I know when it disappears. I know when it fills. I know when it overflows. I know when it shrinks. I know what base there is beneath the sea." The Awen relates to water on so many levels. The flowing spirit of water and the flowing spirit of Awen share many similarities. Both are fluid, able to be contained, and yet have their own freedom in their inherent sense of being. They follow their own currents and can be beneficial when used with respect. When we follow the currents of life, the interconnectedness of all things, we share that flow of Awen and then come to know the fathomless depth that it can bring. We have the shamanic diviners in the Welsh tradition, known as Awenithian, and there is Awen involved in divination and the quest for relationship with the divine. The Awen is a vast subject that requires much study, but more to the point, it requires experience. We can research the similarities between Awen and the Hindu aspects of Shakti, for example, or the Tao in Chinese philosophy. But we must feel the Awen with every atom of our being in order to truly understand it. What is the difference between Awen and the energy of life or the life force? I would say that Awen is the thread that connects us to that life force. When we connect in good relationship to the world around us, those threads shimmer with Awen, with inspiration. We know that we are a part of the web, wholly and utterly connected. When we feel that connection with other beings, soul to soul, and our sense of self lessens, we are inspired by that connection. We then think of ourselves less, and our perception opens out to a wider perspective on the world, one that is more inclusive rather than just our own self-centered point of view. We become a thread in the web. Awen helps us to see beyond ourselves and perhaps paradoxically to allow us to see ourselves in everything. When we see that we are a part of a whole, we are inspired. When we lessen this sense of self, we are able to perceive so much more. When we have expanded our worlds to include everything within it, we become the Awen. The poet Amargin describes this beautifully in what is now known as the Song of Amargin. "I am the wind on the sea. I am the wave of the sea. I am the bull of seven battles. I am the eagle on the rock. I am a flash from the sun. I am the most beautiful of plants. I am a strong wild boar. I am a salmon in the water. I am a lake in the plain. I am the word of knowledge. I am the head of the spear in battle. I am the god that puts fire in the head. Who spreads light in the gathering on the hills? Who can tell the ages of the moon? Who can tell the place where the sun rests?" Many druid rituals begin or end with singing or chanting the Awen. When doing so, the world is stretched to three syllables, sounding like Awen. It is a lovely sound which opens up the heart and soul. Sung or chanted together or in rounds, it simply flows, as its namesake determines. Our hearts can open if we let them when chanting or singing the Awen. Yet I am sure that the Awen is different for each and every druid. The connection and the resulting expression of that connection, the druid's own creativity, can be so vast and diverse. It is what is so delicious about it. We inhale the Awen and exhale our own creativity in song, in dance, in books, in protest marches. The possibilities are endless, as is the Awen itself. We are never born and we can never die. We are simply manifest for a while in one form and then we manifest again in another when the conditions are right. For me, this represents reincarnation, the nitty-gritty basics and the science behind it. The threads that bind all this together are the Awen. The hedge druid sits in the back garden, the soft spring sunlight upon her shoulders. The scent of the earth is rising, mingling with the sunny smell of the daffodils that beam out at her from beneath the beech tree. She can feel the energy rising, the energy of the land. It is both within and without, all around her and also deep inside her soul. She puts her hand upon the mossy ground and feels the connecting threads that run through this land, the threads of Awen that bind everything together. She is at once in her back garden and in the stone circle of Avebury, as well as on Glastonbury Tor and in the field behind her parents' house. She rides the currents of Awen, of connection, and in her soul she is inspired. She feels the flowing spirit of the universe and hums along to the tune. Chapter 3. The Gods. Who are the gods in Druidry? This is a vast question with many different levels of interpretation. I will offer my own view here, on what makes a god. When I use the term god, I am referring to deity of any gender, both and none. How we can honor the gods in our lives, and create a relationship with the deity that provides us with Awen. If you are an atheist or prefer to not work with the gods, then please feel free to proceed to the next chapter. I will recount my own experiences with the deity, in all shapes and forms, and encourage you to seek out your own should you so wish. First, let's define what is a god. In Druidry, we work with the ancestors and the spirits of place, and these can often become interwoven with concepts of deity, their stories, and their form. As a hedge druid, I can make up my own mind about what constitutes deity and what does not, based on both research and experience. For me, deity can be several things. It can be a collective energy of a place in nature. It can also be a collective energy of human nature, such as love, anger, compassion, or time. I prefer to work with a less anthropocentric view toward deity. But when viewing concepts such as love or anger as deity, it can be very illuminating. Deity can also be the collective energy of ancestral stories, where we find named gods in the old tales, such as Brigid or Luge, Tyrannus or Nematona. Examples of the collective energy of a place in nature would be the god of the heath upon which I walk and work, or the god of the North Sea that rolls up and down the coastline where I live. Some of these deities are named and some are not. The god of the heathland has no name or has not shared one with me. The god of the North Sea is sometimes known as Nihilenia, a female deity depicted on altars found in the Netherlands just across the water from where I live on the Suffolk coast. Sometimes the North Sea is just the North Sea, with all its murky waters and shallow depths, an ancient land bridge to the continent lying beneath its waves. When a deity is the collective energy of a place in nature, it is the sum total of all the parts. The parts may consist of the spirits of place, those who live there, animal, vegetable, mineral, the ancestors, again, animal, vegetable, or mineral, beings and fair folk from the other world, and more. More on these subjects in subsequent chapters. Some collective energies of human nature can be seen as deity in order to have a better relationship with that energy. Sometimes putting some specifications on an energy allows us to better relate to it. With nature, it's often easier to communicate to an anthropomorphized deity of the sun seen as a shining male god brandishing a spear of light than it is to honor a huge ball of gas. We can apply that as well to the collective energy of human nature, and so we may see a version of Father Time when we work with the collective energy or the concept of time. There are anthropomorphized gods of love, war, fertility, and more, which help us to relate to these somewhat abstract concepts. For some, There is no need to humanize this energy and simply see it as a flow or current that runs through humanity, accessing it, harnessing it, or working with it. The named gods of mythology and folklore are combined the collective energy of ancestral stories, tales that have been passed down from generation to generation, shared among tribes and peoples. This energy might originally have started as a collective energy of nature or human nature, and become something that now represents the concept, to be passed down along the lineage of human beings and encompassing a broad spectrum of associations. Brigid may have once started as a goddess of fire or of sacred springs or of healing, and has since developed into an anthropomorphized goddess who shares all these attributes and more, with her own stories of how she came about with her powers and of bestowing them upon others. These tales are told, spread from tribe to tribe, eventually creating a deity that is recognized widely, but perhaps having different names. Brigid is also known as Bridge, Brigantia, Bridget, Bridgedy, Bride, Bryant, Fryant, and more. They may have taken on many attributes. Brigid is the goddess of poets, healers, blacksmiths, the season of spring, sovereignty, fire, sacred wells, and more. So why do we need or create gods of any specification? As stated earlier, it is often easier to connect with an abstract energy or concept when we deify and anthropomorphize it. In doing so, we can talk to it, worship it, and work with the energy. It becomes personal. When we correlate a deity with a gender, we are expanding this notion even further, and so the goddess Rhiannon might become an important deity for all women to consider, or Morrigan or Andrasta. We might find a strong kinship with her stories, tales that resonate and reflect our own lives and experiences back to us, perhaps even providing us with guidance on how to get through the difficult times or how to receive the Awen, how to live life fully, and how to die honorably. There are many different forms of incorporating deity into Druid practice. Many Druids are pantheists, where the entirety of the universe is a connected manifestation of deity. We also have polytheism, which is the veneration of more than one deity or many deities, perhaps in a pantheon. Many Druids would advise working in a single pantheon, if one is to work with more than one deity, in order to keep the energy clear. Some deities from differing pantheons might not work very well together. Then again, they just might. It worked for the Romans, who incorporated many British deities into their pantheon. When in Rome, or in Britain, or Gaul, most Druids also work with deities associated with Celtic religion and spirituality, although some have incorporated other deities. To each their own. Some examples of deity found in the Druid tradition are listed. Brigid, goddess of healing, poetry, smithcraft, fire, sacred wells, sovereignty. Lu, a many-skilled god, associated with the festival Lunisod, where he honors his mother, Tail to you. Danu, mother goddess of the Tutha de Danann, associated with water. Morrigan, the great queen, goddess of battle and regeneration. Manana McClear, god of the sea and guardian of the other world. Dagda, god of fertility, magic, renewal. Tail to you, goddess of agriculture, fertility, harvest. Welsh deities. Arianfrud, lady of the silver wheel, of the starry heavens. Clear, god of the sea. Winebnis, ruler of the other world. Anon, the king of the fairies, the Tulwith Teg. Blotha Iwelf, goddess of transformation, liberation. Caraduin, goddess of rebirth, initiation, and inspiration. Gofanon, god of smithcraft. Gaulish and Brythonic deities. Belinus, god of the sun, light. Cernunnos, lord of wild animals, the underworld. Andrasta, goddess of victory, the indomitable one. Coventina, goddess of wells and springs.
Tyrannus, god of thunder. Nodens, god of healing, the sea, and hunting and dogs. Epona, goddess of fertility and all equine. Nematona, goddess of the sacred grove. This is but a short list of the many deities that can be found in the Druid tradition. The descriptions are only a part of the whole of each deity. They are much more than their popular associations. Deity is something to be experienced and not merely called upon due to his or her aspects or associations. When we work with deity, we must first establish a relationship. No one likes to be called up out of the blue by strangers, asking for this or that. No one likes to be known as just having one or two skills and that's all they're good for. No one likes to be pigeonholed. We must truly come to learn all that we can about a deity and then reach out in order to experience fully. If we're very lucky, a deity might choose to work with us, but it is still up to us to find out all about them, to do the work and not just know them in name only. Later in this book, we will design a ritual to dedicate yourself to a particular deity, should you so wish, working with them for however long a period. We will also meet in inner journeys with certain gods such as Gwynabnis, Hearn, and Arianrhod. It is important that you have a personal connection with deity before choosing to dedicate yourself to a particular god or goddess. Perhaps some of these gods may become part of your life. Perhaps not. Deity is an extremely personal experience. And though you may find many similarities between your experience and that of others, you will also find differences. Those differences must be respected in your experience and in that of others. Do not put down someone else's experience because it does not match yours. For who is to say who is right and who is wrong? Only the gods themselves can determine that, and it may be that they choose to present themselves differently to each individual. She prays by the light of the moon to her goddess, Andrasta, lady of the land upon which she lives. She feels her energy in the moonlight, feels her breath upon the cold winter's breeze. An owl hoots in the ash tree and a dog barks once in the darkness. She feels the energy of her goddess all around her, enchanting her soul, filling her with Awen. She knows she has a duty to this land, to her goddess, and she recites a blessing chant upon the pool of water before her, which at other times doubles as a birdbath. She gazes into the water and sees aspects of her goddess appear, the flames of a fire, the shoreline of the beach, the sandy heath and heather-laden countryside, the swift movement of the otter, the utter stillness of the hare. She calls in her mind to her goddess and connects to her deeply, allowing her to imbue her spirit and her work with her blessing. When she is done, the hedge druid bows deeply to the full moon, honoring her for all that she is. Chapter 4. The Ancestors.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.